Books on Tape presents Her Father's House by Belva Plain, read by Karen White. Prologue. One day when I was 4 years old, a girl in school told me that my mother was not my real mother. "Your real one's dead," she said. Is it not strange that I cannot remember what explanation my father gave me when I ran home? I only remember that it was raining hard. I was all wet, and at the front door, the cat was crying to be let in. Part 1. Chapter 1. 1968. His name was Donald Wolfe, Donald J. for James, and he was 25 years old when he joined the stream of eager youth that from every corner of the country, every year, pours into the churning human sea called New York. If it is ever possible, or even makes any sense to say, that someone's geographic origin can be visible on his person, then it made sense to say that Donald looked like just the man to have come from healthy small town or farming people in some cold place like North Dakota, which is exactly where he had come from. He was tall, brown-haired, and large-boned. His brown eyes were thoughtful and calm. On the streets of New York during those first months, he walked with slow deliberation through the impatient crowd, taking his time to estimate the height of a building or pausing to wonder at the heaped-up splendors in the shop windows. Untempted, he merely wondered. Once only was he tempted. In a bookstore's window lay The Writings of Thomas Jefferson, bound in dark red leather. It was expensive, yet the price did not faze him too much, for he hoped to build a library, and he also felt that he owed himself one treat, so he bought it. Never in his life had he had so much money at his command. Having graduated second in his class at law school, he had been hired as an associate in the New York office of an international law firm. Although others in the firm complained that the city, with its high rents, expensive restaurants, and entertainments, left them beggared, he, because he did not go to expensive restaurants and always bought standing room or the cheapest seats at theaters, felt rich. His clean two-room apartment on the fifth floor of a 19th-century walk-up building, with an interesting view of the lively street, was satisfying to him. Sometimes in window glass, he would catch a reflection of himself on his way to work, wearing his correct dark suit with his briefcase at his side. "I can't believe what's happened to me," he would cry out to himself, and then be amused at his own simple-mindedness. "Who do you think you are, anyway, Donald Wolfe? Why, there are dozens of young men just like you in any one of these towering buildings along the avenue." Yet, they were not all quite like him. Senior partners were surely known to be sparing of praise. Still, before the year had passed, he had already received a good deal of it. One of the seniors, a punctilious, middle-aged man, whom a few of the younger people in the office had secretly labeled "typically white shoe," took a liking to him. But even if Augustus Pratt had not taken that liking, Donald never would have scoffed at White Shoe. To begin with, he was not exactly sure what it meant. But if it did mean what he thought, a certain old-fashioned formal courtesy, he would have found no fault with that. One evening, at the conclusion of Aida, Donald came upon Mr. Pratt in the lobby of the opera house. He was accompanied by a woman, obviously his wife, with their three half-grown children. "Why, hello, Donald. I never knew you cared about opera." "I do, although I still don't know much about it." "It's never too late and seldom too early to learn. If I'd known you were here," he said as they walked out together, "we could have had some refreshments. Where were you sitting?" "On top, as high as you can go." "Oh, it was worth it, I'm sure, in spite of the seat." "Yes, sir, it was." "Well, see you in the morning. Good night, Donald." More than once, when, in a later time, he reflected on the chain of events that had moved him through the years, Donald wondered how differently things might have turned out if he had not met Augustus Pratt that night at the opera. Was it the fact that I shared his tastes that impressed him enough to present me with two good seats for the rest of the season? Had that led to those informal conversations which, in their turn, had led to more swift assignments and promotions, and that, in a roundabout way, had led in the end to Lillian, to marriage, and the deadly ruin that came after it. Pratt had grown up in a small town in northern Maine. His father, like Donald's late mother, had been a teacher. He, too, had left for law school, borrowed and worked his way through it, and never returned to the small town. It was this familiar background that made Donald feel particularly comfortable in his presence. "Yes," Pratt said in one of those conversations, "Dakota sounds much like Maine. A hot July and August, then a long winter. My brothers and I worked all day in the potato fields. We worked so late sometimes that our mother brought our dinner to us in a pail. You too, I suppose. Except that I had no brothers or sisters either. Mom had a summer job when school was out. When I got back from the farm where I worked, I'd make supper. If she got home first, she'd make it." "You don't mention your father. Or am I intruding with the question?" "Not at all. He died in France in 1944. I was a year old." "To have a son and never see him grow up," Pratt murmured, then gave Donald a penetrating look. "You would have pleased him, Donald. Our profession, despite the abuses of some lawyers, still demands the highest honor and trust. You are going to be an honored name within it." Donald was to remember another day, 2 years later. "How would you like to go with me to Singapore next month? There's a bank matter there that's come to life again. We thought it was nicely settled, but it isn't." "Like it, Mr. Pratt. Until I came to New York, I'd never been farther than the state capital. Oh, yes, I'd like it." Pratt had smiled. Donald never forgot that smile. A little pleased, a little amused, and even perhaps a little bit, well, fatherly. "You'll see a lot more than Singapore in your time, Donald." There was so much that he needed to see and do and learn. The world was 1,000 times larger and fuller than he could have imagined. In the courtroom, as part of a team accompanying a senior partner, he saw the human.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.